Paul, are we ready?
I am, just.
Gail?
Yes.
Good evening. Welcome to our regularly scheduled meeting of October 17th, 2016. Amy, if you can lead us.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dolores?
Counselor Bello?
Here.
Counselor Hemon?
Here.
Counselor Hurley?
Here.
Counselor Latina?
Here.
Counselor Martino?
Here.
Counselor Rell?
Here.
Counselor Spinella?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Berry?
Here.
And Mayor Montanari?
Here. Thank you, Dolores. There are no hearings. Public comment? Anyone wishing to speak this evening? Public comment? Gus?
Good evening. Gus Colantonio, 16 Morrison Avenue. Guess what I'm going to talk about tonight? obviously, I'm talking about, going to talk about traffic on Morrison Avenue, lack of stop sign. And basically, I guess, you know, on more than one occasion, I was told that I got all the answers to the question that I asked. Maybe I'm going senile, getting older, and I don't remember everything. The only answer that I remember is that there is not enough traffic on Morrison Avenue. And the other one is that there are too many stop signs in town. We don't want to put any more. But I still have a question or two for the town manager. This was done, I guess, June in 2011. When you took measurements for the intersection site distance on Hillcrest and Orchard, and you found that looking toward the east, the intersection site distance 344 feet. Looking toward the west, it's 970 feet from Orchard. Now the question that I have, now that you have the dimensions, what have you done? Apparently you haven't done anything. And I have to ask, why did you take dimension and waste tons of money? Because obviously there is nothing wrong with the intersection. There is nothing wrong with the intersection on site distance. There are three stop signs, and as a result of that, Morrison Avenue has twice as many cars on a daily basis than Hillcrest. Hillcrest has a 15-foot grass strip. Morrison Avenue in one section doesn't have anything at all. And let me say it again that when I measure the intersection of site distance from Tifton in the westbound direction from Tifton on Morrison Avenue, I came up with 240 feet, and I was told that you used the yardstick. Subsequent to that, the town did take their own measurements, and they measured 232 feet with no stop signs. Now, the question that I have for all of you, Hillcrest and Orchard, as I say, has 344 and 970 with stop signs. Now, why can we get a stop sign on Tifton and Morrison Avenue with 232 feet. People go 31 miles per hour. Yes, Tony, you never came to see it, but that's true. People go 31 miles per hour, the 85th percentile. That means that 15% of the traffic on Morrison Avenue is going above 31 miles per hour. The posted speed is 25. The intersection side distance, it's only good for 24. And you guys, nine of you, don't see anything wrong with it. God bless you. I'm still waiting for the answers, except for the one I told you already. If there are any more, let me know. Thank you.
Thank you, Gus. Yes.
Hi, good evening. David DeCarly, 7 Monticello Drive. You have a handout that I had passed out earlier, and that's the reason I'm here. I'm saddened by the mayor's most recent Facebook post on the Wethersfield Democratic Town Committee's Facebook page. Sure. So again, this is in response to Mayor Montaneri's post, most recent post, October 11th, on the Wethersfield Democratic Town Committee's Facebook page. It saddens me, and I'm saddened for all of Wethersfield, actually, because as the mayor, you represent all of Wethersfield. Whether we're Democrats, Republicans, unaffiliated, independents, you represent all of Wethersfield. And I'm going to read a couple pieces out of this, and again, you have that handout. This was posted on October 11th at 4:52 in the morning. Two important points about Hurley for Wethersfield. Number one, he continues to have a Trump sign on his lawn long after the revelations that Trump is a sexual assaulter. Do we want to consider a state representative that condones sexual assault? Many Republicans around the country, including the House Speaker Ryan, have essentially denounced him, and many indicating they no longer can endorse, not Mr. Hurley. Number two, Mr. Hurley has posted on his Hurley for Wethersfield commentary suggesting that the Fun Zone redevelopment project was done without communication to the full council. At a special meeting 2 weeks ago called by the Council of Republicans, he acknowledged after probing that, quote, several months ago, he was actually briefed by the town manager, in parentheses at my urging, about the general scope of the pending project and that it would be on the bond agenda shortly. In fact, TM advised Mr. Hurley to watch for it on the upcoming bond commission reports. While the town of Wethersfield has no such position as minority leader, Hurley is fond of calling himself that, meets biweekly with the town manager, et cetera, et cetera, and goes on to talk about those things. I actually want to focus on number one, because clearly you represent Wethersfield, as I said before, and what you've written in number one in response to Mr. Hurley, and whether it's Mr. Hurley or any other member of the town council, it's irresponsible, it's capricious, and it's repugnant. In slamming him the way you did, it's an embarrassment to this town, and it's actually an embarrassment to every Democrat sitting here and registered in Wethersfield. Whether you like it or not, you and all the town council members here are held to a higher standard. And so to write those things it's disappointing, to say the least. So let's flip it, which is number one. If you're going to equate Mr. Hurley or the Republicans for that matter as being in the same line as Mr. Trump, as far as I know, and as far as I've read in the newspaper and seen in the news, Mr. Trump has not been convicted as a sexual assaulter. So to put Mr. Hurley in that category is irresponsible, and you should be called for an apology immediately. And if we flip it again and we say that since you're a Democrat, then that must mean you delete emails, you lie about it, you potentially jeopardize the safety and security of the nation or the town by using a private server to conduct your business, or that you say one thing to one group and one thing to another group, right? That's what Hillary's being accused of. So my question is, are you the same? And I wouldn't say that. I'm asking the question. Is Russ Morin, because there's a picture of Mayor Montaneri with Russ Morin. Russ Morin is running for state representative. Is he in the same boat as Hillary Clinton because he's a Democrat? Is the Democratic Party in the same boat? So your post says a lot. And I'm going to talk about one more thing, which is I work in a school system. And we teach our kids all the time about safe work with the internet, posting, Facebook, Instagram, Snapchatting, what to do, what not to do. A lot of times we have outside people come in and they will talk to our students. We recently had someone come into the school that I work in. and he did a great job. And one of the things that he spoke about is never post when you're angry. And it doesn't take a lot to read into words. And maybe that's the problem with postings nowadays, that we read into them. But there's anger in there. There's personal attacks in there. You're a professional. You should be responsible. And there's no place for that. And so one of the things that he talked about and he teaches our, taught our teenagers about is he has a hashtag, and it's hashtag think. So before you post something, before you email something, before you say something, he says hashtag think. Think about it. Write it. Go ahead and write that. Write that post and let it sit. Let it sit for 5 minutes, 10 minutes. You posted that at 4:52 a.m. I bet you at 5 o'clock in the morning, if you went back and read that, you probably would have taken that back. I probably said that was unprofessional, and it was something I shouldn't have done. So I don't know how many people saw that, but it's disappointing to me, and I think as the town council, it should be disappointing to you. And I'm not sure if the town council has the power to do so, but I think the town council should consider some version of censorship, because if this is what certainly the Democrats are putting out there, or the Republicans have to contend with, I don't know how much can actually get done in this town. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dave.
Can you all hear me? Because I'm not used to this mic. I'm Marie Alfonso, and I'm a Wethersfield resident. I live at 256 Springfield Road. Okay.
One of these days we're going to have
I'm just short, and I embrace being so bear with me, and just tell me if you don't hear me. As I said, I live at 256 Springfield Road in Wethersfield. I'm here in support of the mayor's free speech, and I'm going to express my free speech as a private citizen at this point. I feel strongly about what I'm going to say, so I put it down to paper. I'll talk as quickly as I can because I know time is of the essence. I strongly believe that to vote and support in any way for DT, I refuse to pronounce his name at this point, given the positions he has taken across the board over a year's time. I view it as a moral decision one has to make to vote for DT and to support him in any way. To vote for him is basically to morally justify his racism, his sexism, and all the isms that I can't even begin to embrace, but he certainly embraces. To vote and support for this candidate requires, or any candidate, reviewing and accepting a candidate in his or her totality. You can't pick and choose folks' character traits. You need to see them all, and you can't pick the ones you like and discard the ones you don't want when making a decision as important as voting for the President of the United States. To vote for DT is to embrace his, and I will go down the list fairly quickly, his racism, his sexism, his xenophobia, his anti-immigrant and anti-refugee sentiments, his homophobia, his religious intolerance. It isn't just against Muslims. I've been waiting, and if he finally did his veiled anti-Semitism when he referred to international bankers, I felt like I was watching reels from World War II, his disdain for persons with all kinds of disabilities. To vote for DT is to embrace his love of fascism and autocrats. Putin seems to be his favorite. I'm Cuban, of Cuban descent, so I have a personal disdain and hatred for anything that smacks of fascism, autocrats, communism. It's all the same to me. To vote for him is to also embrace his disdain for the rule of law. He attacks an American judge from Indiana because he's of Mexican-American descent. He violates labor laws with regard to wages. When people work for him, he does not pay them. He certainly does not respect the right to collectively organize and fight for your rights as groups. He breaches contracts with private vendors and small businesses by simply not paying them. I come from the place of the law encapsulates the basic concept of one should always keep one's promises. He breaks those promises by not paying his debts. He violated the Cuban embargo restrictions imposed by Congress. The fact that he's not being prosecuted doesn't change the fact he violated it and doesn't deny it. To embrace him is also to embrace his disrespect of the military men and women who have served with distinction and those who have mental disabilities because of their service. He claims that their job is terrible, they've done a horrible job. That's disrespecting their service. He provides no specifics on how to address the suicide rates, which are only climbing with soldiers returning from the various wars. His disrespect for veterans and service families is unbelievable to me, attacking Mr. and Mrs. Khan, who lost their son, who sacrificed the ultimate sacrifice, which is for his country, and criticizing Senator John McCain because he was captured as a prisoner of war is unbelievable. His disdain for legal institutions, again, his attack on the judiciary, attack on any member of the bench is an attack on the whole bench. You're attacking the ultimate representative of the rule of law. His disdain for political institutions, he's attacking GOP officials who disagree with him. He's even attacking Speaker Ryan, simply because he chooses not to engage in some of the more deplorable, and I use the word because it's appropriate, comments he's made, independently of the allegations of sexual harassment and beyond. He also has a disdain for governmental institutions. He accuses Republican and Democratic elected officials of conducting rigged elections. He has a complete disdain for the free press. It manifests itself in ways such as he denies press access to his rallies whenever it suits him periodically. He does, sometimes he allows it, sometimes he doesn't. He alleges that the press is partaking in some kind of conspiracy to destroy him as they uncover and report serious allegations of misconduct. The press is doing its job to report allegations once they do their investigations, but he accuses them of some conspiracy to destroy him. He also denies the validity of science. He's a climate change denier, and he has a complete disregard for anything that remotely resembles facts and the truth. But however you feel about all this, and you can tell I feel strongly on this, I will conclude by saying that the trust in the integrity of our institutions, including our political parties, is an indispensable tool which helps keep our republic and our democracy intact. And this man is doing everything he can to destroy our respect for the integrity of all our institutions, political and otherwise. And his goal clearly is to have you disrespect, and all of us disrespect, the integrity of our institutions, including this, from ground up. And once you accept that fact, you're willing to give up all your constitutional rights in exchange for giving all the authority to him to make everything well and fine. If that's not the definition of a fascist and an autocrat, pick a country, pick a history, pick a nation. That's it. And thank you very much for your time. And this is, I'm exercising my right as an American. I'm exercising my right as a naturalized American. My parents came here, and this I don't have in the speech, but as a political refugee, so did I. So I take personal issue with anyone who thinks that someone can stand up there and attack people who they don't know and make assumptions about them without knowing who they are. And I'm standing here, not for me, because I'm at the tail end. I'm not 20 anymore. If I'm standing here for every other person who came before me, I'm certainly standing here for my parents, standing here for my father, who died. But he died thinking this country was what some people are trying to make it not to be. My parents thought this was the beacon of democracy, and that's why they came here, running away from communism and all the dictatorship that comes along with it. So I'm not standing here for myself. I'm standing here for everyone who goes to vote. And vote however you will. I will fight for your right to vote for Trump, for anyone you want to vote for. And you can have all the lawn signs you want. I don't care. But I am terrified, and that is the word. And I've been terrified for almost a year listening to a man who's basically trying to demean our democracy and having few people willing to stand up. And I'm only one voice, but I hope enough of our voices come forward and speak. And vote your conscience is a the conclusion of what I'm saying, and thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak publicly? Yeah.
My name Lila Mandor, and I live at 420 Ridge Road. And Maria, thank you for your words. And I'm not going to get into my specific beliefs. I'm a naturalized citizen as well, and I think this is a great country. And I think if somebody... Sorry. I think freedom of speech is very, very important. It's what this country was founded upon. And without getting into the substantive issues of the candidates and what they believe in and what they, you know, what they stand for, I will say that if somebody puts a lawn sign on their lawn, then they're basically endorsing whoever it is whose name is on that sign. And if that's what they choose to do publicly, then I think their duty is that they need to be able to defend their choice. I don't think, I just respectfully disagree with you that the mayor called the councilman, you know, whatever it is that you believe he called him. I think he just said he supports this man, and he put out there, you know, is that what we want? I mean, that's what he believes, and I think he has a right to say it. I don't think he should be ashamed of it. I don't think there's an apology in order. He is not calling anybody by any name. He is only saying that this is what this person believes, and is that what we want? That's a question. If somebody came to me and said, you have this lawn sign on your lawn, and, you know, are you this, are you that, are you that? I'm prepared to defend myself. I'm prepared to answer those questions. So that's it. Thanks.
Anyone else wishing to speak publicly? Bob?
Good evening, Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. Mayor, I did see that article as well that you wrote, or those passages, and I was disappointed. I think Mr. Hurley has every right to put a sign up. Okay, I'll start over again. My name is Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. I saw your passages, not that I'm a Facebook reader or writer, I don't even go there, but it's been floating around. And very disappointing to see those comments coming from our leader regarding one of our other council members. I could make all kinds of comments about each and every one of you, and it doesn't matter. It's acceptable. You're public servants. But I think when one does it to another, especially the mayor does it to one of his underlings, who is competing against one of your guys in an election, I don't think was correct. I know we won't see that again, happen again, so that's good. But the fact is, it was wrong. Shouldn't have happened. We have a lot of other problems. You know, at the last town council meeting, it was discussed very briefly about this apartment house or this fun zone that some developer is getting some $5 million from the state of Connecticut. That's the bankrupt state of Connecticut. And, you know, I just cannot understand how the bankrupt state can give somebody $5 million that's a subsidy. It's going to be forgiven if he meets certain conditions. And, you know, And do we need apartment houses in this town? No, we need businesses to come into this town. That's where we make a better dollar. We lose dollars when we have apartments. But you, Mayor, you brought that forward. And again, that's a disappointment. It's like you brought forward and leaded the taking or the, what's it called, the Standish House some years ago, that lease, that we get $100 a year and they're getting $42,000 a year. It doesn't make economic sense. But again, we have you. And here we are. We're you know, I keep talking about the budget for the state of Connecticut. And here it is. It says that they're going to begin, Malloy suggests a 10% trim. Are we going to have a 10% trim? You know, if he's saying we got to trim 10% of our budget, his budget, we should be trimming our budget as well. And matter of fact, we should have known this. We should have known this because we are smart people. We should have known this before when we were doing our budget, and we should have reduced our budget by 10% instead of going into 3, 4, 5, 6 months before we start to trim. That's a disaster, and that's exactly what happened to the Malloy administration last time in their annual budget. They didn't cut, they held back, they played games, and then they get to the end, up, oh, we're short $170 million. Where are we going to get it? Oh, we'll take it out of the, what do they call it? That fund.
Rainy day fund.
Rainy day fund. And I'm sure we have a rainy day fund that we'll end up taking from when we need to, right? If we won't cut, we'll take from our rainy day fund. And that's what the state of Connecticut's been doing. They've been floating bonds, if you've noticed. The last one I showed you was $1 billion. You know how many, I don't know how many dollars they would have gotten for their premium, the bond premium that they then take and put somewhere else to spend. It's more money than $1 billion that they end up borrowing. They end up borrowing $1 billion plus, yet we only know it's $1 billion. And how many billions have they borrowed at the state level to keep the towns going? Because the towns refuse to cut back on their budgets, cut back on your expenditures. You're the fault when the state goes down the tubes. Everyone. You don't cut, you don't do, you force the state to pony up more money for you? Or you come back to us and tell us we have to pay more? You'll have a revolt. And you deserve that revolt. You get the revolt now from me, and you know it's going to happen later. Then, of course, you want to help out the great city of Hartford. And here it is. Bond rating is reduced again for Hartford. You know, another bankrupt operation. The whole thing has been a Ponzi scheme. A Bernie Madoff, if we all remember that name. You have it right here in Connecticut. And you guys are part of it. You guys will go down in history as part of it. Remember the names that you put on the walls in these buildings. Your names are on there. We'll never forget you. Then tonight there was some discussion regarding, a little more regarding Russ Warren, the great architect of high tax borrow and spend. He started it right here in Wethersfield and went to Hartford. And he continued with his tax, borrow, and spend. When Malloy came in, they whacked us with a big tax increase. Just last year, they whacked us with another. Now they're in such bad shape, they don't even want to talk about what it's going to be until after the election. The best thing anybody could do is don't vote for any of those idiots up there and vote for anybody else that's running. And in the town of Wethersfield, we have Mr. Hurley, who's over here running. And we have some guy named Johnson, Lee Johnson. I met him this weekend. He's a Democrat. Seemed like a nice guy. He seemed like he would tighten up on the money issues. Of course, he has no choice if he ever got in. He has to tighten up. And then, of course, we have Catone Field. Another sad story of more borrowed money coming up. We had a speaker up here at the last town council meeting who was talking about the artificial turf needs to be replaced. Well, we've been hearing about that. The issue is, where's all the revenue? that's been collected, and I've been asking about this. I'm going to come down and see the manager Friday, and I'm going to sit down with
Friday.
You won't have it. Yeah, you won't be here. I'll get you the next Friday. But the fact is, I want to come down and I want to see what your attendance has been all of these years. I want to see what the revenue has been that you've collected. I want to see what your expenditures are. And of course, I'd like to know the equipment that's used to take care of that field. Because back when you talked about putting turf on the field, there was no mention at that point about any equipment that was needed. But then right afterwards, you had to go out and buy a number of items. Just more non-transparency. But that this manager here, he's pretty good about transparency. He opens up his book and he shows me what I want, you know, what I've asked for. So I commend him for that. But again, we need to tighten our belts. I think the town of Wethersfield, knowing that the state is looking at a 10% reduction, we should be looking at that same reduction plus. Because we don't want to get in the same, because we don't want to be in the position they're in. We want to be in a better position. So, but thank you very much, Mayor,
thank you, Bob,
for the time.
Yep, thank you.
And I will be back.
Other public comment? George?
Gotta remember to speak up, George, so people can hear you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. George A. Rue, 956 Cloverdale Circle. I know that part by heart. And it's been a very interesting meeting so far this evening. And in the past, there are many, many times I have shared similar thoughts on the ability to speak from this podium. And it's always been pretty well received, I gotta say that much, for us, for the councils. Our board doesn't get such good jobs. But in any event, I'd like to share a few thoughts with you tonight. Thoughts, not necessarily criticisms, but things that I think our council can do in this upcoming election. This election will be a high watermark of sorts for me, happening in November. Because it'll probably be the last presidential election I'll ever be able to vote in. Because the next one's gonna be in 2020, and I'm gonna be 96, and I'm well past my allocated time already. At least that's what my doctor tells me. He says you're in good shape, George, but you're past the time. You know, that's how come you ache and hurt all over the place. So in any event, of late, I have addressed a number of issues relative to the election. And to me, this election is the most important thing that this country's facing right now. It's the most important thing we're facing. And there has been a great deal of talk on fraud. Fraud here, fraud there, and so forth and so on. And is there fraud? Sure, there's some fraud. Some numbers that I read just recently, the number of fraud cases out of umpteen bazillion votes was, I don't know, a small number, like zero practically. And in all of the years where I was a moderator, when I was the moderator, were there some fraudulent votes cast? Probably. Did I know about them? Probably not. I know I can say I did not. But did they have a big impact? Not really. They didn't really have that. So I'm not here to advocate that people should fraudulently vote. As far as I can tell, and from what I've read, the electoral system, the electoral process in the state of Connecticut using the equipment that is currently in use does not lend itself easily to fraud. And I can accept that. There are some states where it's more likely, but as far as Connecticut is concerned, as far as I understand, it's an unlikely thing. What concerns me more is the entree into the voting venue. And I have addressed this a number of times lately, and I've shared some of my own experience when I voted, and I said I didn't have an ID, and I had to go to town hall, they told me, and then I didn't do that, and the moderator finally realized that I didn't have to do that. But anyway, we wasted time. And I was also concerned about the manual process of shuffling papers when the voters came in, as time-consuming, because I think as a number of people, have, and I believe this, we, the citizens of this town, all of us that are here, we're the sort of like the frontline soldiers. We're the ones that make the battles win or lose or however, from whatever perspective you want to look at an election. But we are the frontline troops. And I think it's incumbent on all of our elected officials, and I don't know exactly who's in charge of the election process, whether it's Dolores and our staff or the registrars and our staff, but I hold you all responsible, personally, every single one of you, is to make certain that you get out. And maybe rather than stand with signs, you know, pushing your favorite candidates, leave that to people like me. Well, I'm not going to do that either, but the frontline soldiers. I'm liable to go around and see people hanging around within the boundary lines and go up and say, hey, get out of here. And I had to throw a couple of very well-known politicians outside the boundary line some years back when they infringed on my territory of responsibility. I wouldn't name who they were. But in any event, I think the concern is if the voting process is delayed through ineptitude or incompetence or poor systems or more bodies that maybe don't reduce time, that people may become discouraged and go home and vote. And battles in war, and that seems to be what we're in these days, don't get won by people going home and the generals that are leading, so to speak, make certain that things happen with great alacrity and good speed and in good order. So that's the thought I want to leave you with, all of you. I think on both sides of the aisle, it's incumbent that you make sure that that process goes smoothly and that the moderators can do more than just sit behind the table waiting for somebody to say, hey, Mr. Moderator, come over here, I got a problem. That they take the lead and be leaders in making certain that things run smoothly and effectively. So with that, gentlemen, I'm keeping my fingers crossed. Peace.
Thank you. Other public comment? We'll move on to council reports. Any council reports this evening? Donna.
Attended the Shade Tree Commission meeting last Tuesday. They continue to work hard between Corey identifying priorities and bringing those back to the commission to look at, you know, the scope of work that needs to be done. There's a lot of work and not enough resource to do it.
Thank you, Donna. Any other council reports?
I did attend the building committee meeting last Monday. Again, it's winding down. As far as the financial side, the contingency is at, I believe, $360,000, $365,000, I think. The end of October is when construction is scheduled to be complete, and the construction areas will be turned over to the school and to the board, and that's on schedule as well, so that's good news. Obviously, there'll be punch list items and a number of things to do after that. The pool is ready for turnover. I think the board had to do some things to get the pool ready for the swimmers to come back in, but essentially that's ready for turnover. And that's really it. Exciting time again, as I always say, but it's we're getting down to the stretch. There was home stretch. There was discussion about the rooftop screening. The one or two of the units have been painted. I know some of the neighbors were happy with the with the color of that paint, but I think certainly the subcommittee on the building committee is going to be discussing the screening and as well. But that at some point will be before the committee, and then I'm sure before us at some point in time, either at the end of the year or in the springtime. So that's it for the building committee.
Can I ask one question about the building? Are they in the pool now, swimming, like practicing, or?
I don't think they've gone in yet. They weren't as of last Wednesday, Jeff, you can tell me.
They finished filling it today, so they'll spend the next few days heating and balancing the water. So as soon as that's done, then they'll open it up to swimmers. But it is full of water. It's clean. So once they can balance it, get the health department in there to sign off on it, then they should open up to the swimmers.
Good.
Council reports, any others? Just briefly, this Wednesday, the six mayors that have been meeting are going to have another meeting. There'll be one of hopefully two more before the end of the year. I want to be sure that folks understand. I think there was an article, I think, in Wethersfield Life about the composition of that group and our sort of our themes and the intent of that group. I just want to reiterate one thing that I think has floated out there that I think has been somewhat inaccurately reported. In the issue of Hartford and taxes and Wethersfield's resources, want to reiterate there has not been any discussion among any of the mayors in that group about any tax revenue from any of their respective municipalities being diverted or used to assist Hartford in any manner with respect to their issues. Mayor Bronin, who has been a part of the group, has certainly participated in the discussions and has shared the challenges of the greater Hartford area, as well as obviously the financial needs of Hartford. I would say across all party lines within the group, there is certainly an appreciation of Hartford's challenge and the financial issues that are plaguing the city of Hartford. And they obviously are facing some very difficult decisions, which include obviously the discussion about bankruptcy. But the five mayors that represent the other towns, and there are Republican and Democrat mayors at the table, certainly appreciate that each of our respective communities have our own financial challenges. So the reference that there has been made to regionalization has talked about things like purchasing of equipment together, maximizing possible synergies with respect to larger purchases that we can share, paving of roads that might be synchronized to allow for some savings. For example, I cite this example a couple of times, and I think I cited it in the Wethersfield Life article, but Kitts Lane in Newington was paved roughly in the same period of paving period as Two Rod Highway in Wethersfield, Kitts being in Newington. And I'm talking with General Paving some point after that project was done, there was a gap there. And if we had some communication between the towns, which was not typically common, we probably could have staged that paving job as one job and saved the cost of double staging, which is a significant part, frankly, of the project for paving. So having discussion like that, which hasn't happened in the past very frequently, is very helpful, frankly. And so I want to, I guess, assure this council as well as our community that those discussions are brainstorming sessions. We've actually had a meeting with the town managers from several of the district towns to also share their ideas, and we're going to continue to do that. I would tell you that the group is productive, thoughtful, but any impression that this group, particularly since I have publicly supported Hartford and the talk about regionalization to support Hartford's challenges, really talk about a much broader sort of cheerleading role on behalf of Hartford's challenges. And my other comments, I think, have been shared publicly, but not included in that list is any sharing of our tax revenue or resources for our town. I would not support that. I frankly don't think any of the mayors would support that. And certainly if there was any thought in that direction, that would be a council decision that I would bring back. So I want to make sure we're clear on that because that has been out there incorrectly. Council comments this evening on anything? Tony?
I just wanted to report that last Thursday, I attended the ribbon cutting for Massaro Financial Group down on Garden Street. It was a few people showed up for that one, and I like to say this is the second business this year that has moved from Rocky Hill to Wethersfield. It's been in a reverse in the past, so I'm glad to see that we're attracting businesses from out of town to come back to Wethersfield.
Thank you. Council comments? Any other comments?
I had a question. I was just interested in what you were talking about with this mayor's group. Is that through a specific entity?
It isn't, Jody. It kind of came up informally after we took office last year, and the seeds of it, I think CCM or one of the other groups had started a discussion group, and Somebody had something out there which sparked the idea. I can't remember what. But
we did that. We worked together, the same group, okay. Minus Hartford.
How many years ago? When you were in office, I assume?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that might have been part of where I
heard
it.
And they did it prior to me.
Mid-state.
Yes, correct. That's right. So it came out of that informally, and we just reached out to the mayors through emails and said, why don't we talk?
No, I'm just wondering, because I know that CCM is doing something,
yep.
And CROG is doing something, so it's almost duplicative.
It is.
So everyone should actually be.
Yeah, absolutely correct, and that's a very fair observation that we are going to talk about Wednesday, trying to synergize that a little bit better. And again, ours were more informal, but we do have the emails from CCM and CROG about that, and several of the mayors within the group are splintered
same,
into those
yeah.
groups, so they're you know, their time is precious, which is one of the reasons we haven't been able to meet. So I think one of the things that will come out of it is the first thing, frankly, on the discussion, to your point, Jody, is figuring out should we be putting our energy into one of those other groups and simplifying it. So, you know, a great observation, and obviously we're aware of it and got to address that. Any other council? Mike Rowe, and then Mike Rowe.
Along those same lines as for regionalization, the email we just got today from Jeff regarding the MDC and the shortfall, Hartford's financial situation. I think Hartford's the largest municipality in the MDC, 26%. There were a number of bullet points about what the MDC may plan on doing if they do fall under a shortfall of revenue from Hartford. Number four was work with the state, the city, and other member towns on a legislative solution. I just hope that legislative solution is not, you know, increasing rate for surrounding towns to help Hartford out. So maybe, Jeff, if you are working with the MDC at all mm-hmm. on those.
I attend those budget committee meetings.
At least from this person's standpoint, and I don't know who else is, maybe keep our ratepayers in Wethersfield in mind when
always.
And if they decide to come to a legislative action that might include member towns to help out Hartford. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Mike Hurley.
The Keene Foundation's biggest fundraiser was held this weekend. Many of us volunteer there every year, and I think it was the biggest success they've ever had because they had such good weather. And my last thing, just to answer Mr. Montaneri, I do not condone sexual assault.
Thank you, Mike.
Donna? I had the opportunity to play and attend the Grantsway Foundation tournament this past weekend. They continue to work really hard to raise funds to put the bridge between Field 1 and Field 2 at Millwoods. It was a great day, and they really are working hard to make that happen. And also had the opportunity to walk through the carnival and see a lot of happy faces, and Judy was very positive about the attendance, so that was nice. And the same concerns that Mike Rell addressed about the MDC budget hearings to make sure. I know sometimes our comments fall on deaf ears, and I read the report that we got regarding from the CEO that he gives at the monthly commission meeting, and you know, I'm still disappointed that I know that, you know, they consider the reserves and the deficit and the amount of water that they have, but as you watch and watch and watch, and the fact that we've not had any serious precipitation, you look to see what other water companies have done, and we have not seen any of that, but I'm really concerned, and I said that up front when they were going to put the bottling plant in. What kind of safeguards will be put into place with regard to the member towns when a situation just like this happens? Because we won't be protected, yet a business is going to take water. Is there a contingency plan during that process that if it continues in a deficit that they will not sell water to the bottling plant? I don't think so, but it doesn't protect our member towns. And if you looked at the figures, We're down to 18 months. Now, while that may seem like a long time, in the scope of things, a year and a half goes by really quick. And if we have this same kind of drought as has been happening for well over a year now, we're going to be in real trouble.
The 18 months is the reserve?
The reserve. It's what
as
they...
As of right now, correct?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Jeff, could we get some information on that? You know, the pending project, what point it would, to Donna's point, with the MDC.
On the drought management plan?
Yeah, I mean, I think maybe some summary of that. I know there has been some discussion, and I know I spoke to Bill about it back in August a bit, and he referred to the reserves, but I think it would be good if we could get a report.
So we're talking about water reserves?
Well, and
water
just
reserves,
with the
and just what's
drought.
The contingency related to businesses that are purchasing water for their own profit from the purview of our water authority.
Versus the communities, obviously.
Right. What's
right.
The priority?
I mean, our member towns should be the first priority. I get the revenue piece.
Right, right.
But, you know, we're stewards, and we need to look to the future. Right now it's...
Sure.
I agree. I think it's a good question. I think
not
we
great.
Should get that information. So okay. Thank you. Set with comments?
I just want to, if I could take a moment, I just wanted to express that I do support Mike Hurley. I think that he's an upstanding citizen. He gives of his time here and has done so for many years. And I think it's unfortunate that, like we all say, it's the silly season. So I would hope that we could elevate the conversation because clearly we have a lot of huge issues here that we're dealing with. And everyone's having some good, congenial conversation about some important things that affect our town and our residents. So I would hope that we could continue that for the remainder of the election season.
Jeff, anything? Town manager report?
We got a letter from DOT. They're going to be revisiting some traffic signalization across the region. One of the things they're looking at is the traffic signal at Route 75 and Gulf Road. They're going to update those signals, but part of this process, and there's 14 different signals in this region that they're going to look at. One of them is whether or not it's actually necessary. Now, I don't anticipate them finding it's not necessary, but that's one of the things they have to look at. But they are going to update the signals at Gulf and Route 175. We don't know when, but they're going to do that. The Connecticut Green Bank, we still have about $18,000 there from a grant from some energy projects we did years ago. The original proposal was to put 4 solar panels on the community center, but we couldn't make the electric connection. So we're going to look at alternative energy saving projects with that $18,000. We're reviewing town buildings and boilers and lighting systems and so forth. And then tonight you're going to vote or look at the other energy program, and there's $10,000 there that we're going to have to develop a program for the community. So good stuff. We're getting back into the energy projects now that the high school is winding down and we've freed up some resources elsewhere. So that's all good news.
Mayor, could I just ask one more question of Jeff? In regards to the traffic signals, can you find out what the, and maybe you already know this, the philosophy is or the different changes that they're making by backing up the walkways from the intersections? It just, and then there the stop lines are back too. Is it to free up the intersect? I just would be interested to hear what's behind that.
Federal DOT's standard is that each crossing needs its own crossing signal. So you have to separate the push button signals. So that's why they're moving them. They're putting in secondary ones for other, and that's what they did. So everybody needs their own button. That's why that is.
There are also extra poles at those intersections now that the new lights have been hung. Are those old poles going to be taken away?
Yeah, okay. They'll clean all that up.
Okay.
But that's the primary reason for the change in the crosswalks is that each direction needs its own push button light to control that crossing.
Mike, Steve had a question. Jeff?
Jeff, if you could answer or actually inquire again, related to the MDC, the smell in all Wethersfield. When we were here last, it was perhaps the water was low, and that was the answer. I don't know if that is true, not true. where we are on that, but if we could look into that and get a sort of a definitive answer and what the plan is to deal with that, because it, I mean, I haven't noticed it this week, I don't think, but I've noticed it. Okay, because pretty frequently it's been pretty bad.
And that is the answer. You've got exposed mud banks that have a lot of decaying matter, organics that are breaking down, and they're exposed. So it's not a sewage issue; it's an organics issue in those areas. Once we get some more rain, that should help out. But it is the low water levels, and you're not getting the refresh, particularly in the cove, that you might have otherwise. So
what makes Donna's question all the more important then?
Yeah. Absolutely. But that's, we've had the health department look at it, the MDC look at it, CRRA's been looked at. It's just there's low water in the river, in the cove.
Thanks, Jeff.
Mike? Just to follow up on Donna, I got a question today actually from somebody about the intersections, specifically the redesigning of the intersections for handicap accessibility, but now with the additional light signal walks. Is that being paid for by federal DOT, state DOT, town funds? Do we know?
No town funds are in that. It's state or federal, depending on how DOT, state DOT is working that program, but the town's not participating financially in those.
Still taxpayer money somehow,
mm-hmm.
just not from our own budgets.
Towns,
I had a question on the MDC.
Thank you.
Why does it only smell there, but like, it doesn't smell like when I'm up by the river in Hartford or other areas? It seems like it's contained to where the MDC is.
I don't know.
I mean, they come back with that answer, but it seems like that's where the smell is coming from. So you go to other parts of the river, it doesn't smell like that.
I can ask.
Dolores, anything?
Yeah, I'd just like to remind people that in Connecticut, November 1st is the last day to register to vote. Absentee ballots always have to be returned by the 8 o'clock election day. Otherwise, they are not counted. I will be open on November 5th, Saturday, 9 to 1, to issue absentee ballots. And if you miss the November 1st deadline, we have in Connecticut the Election Day registration. So that means Election Day from 6 to 8, people can come. It's going to be in town council chambers, can come and register to vote and then cast their ballot. And they would cast it here. That's it.
Go ahead, Jeff.
And we got a $4,000 grant from the Hartford Foundation for Public Giving for the food bank. So annually we get that donation. So that's good stuff.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Council action. We'll move into acceptance of resignations. Councilor Rell.
From the Youth Advisory Board, Leslie Asoyan, 94 Randy Lane. Her resignation is effective October 7th, 2016.
And Tony?
Second.
I'm sorry. We have a motion and a second. In favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. Tony on Central Connecticut.
From the Central Connecticut Health District, the acceptance of the resignation of Angela G. Colantonio from 16 Morrison Avenue, effective October 5th, 2016.
Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. There's no unfinished business. We'll move on to B3A.
I'd like to make a motion to approve having an outside beer garden at the Holidays on Main event upon proper insurance, security, and permits being resolved.
I second that.
Motion a second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. Diane McAdams, who's the chairperson of Holidays on Main this year, is here to talk about this. There's a letter on the podium tonight. It's on private property, but we just want the council to be aware of it and kind of see if there's concerns before we move forward with this. And this is the last meeting until late November. And so Diane's here to kind of bring this up and talk to you about it.
Hi, Diane.
Hello, everybody. Diane McAdams, 108 Eastern Drive. I'm here to talk about a happy occasion, Holidays on Main. Holidays on Main attracts, I don't know, we don't, you know, as we don't take attendance, around 7,000 people to our town. And it's a lighthearted event, and it's a lot of fun. This year, we made $550, and we wouldn't have made that if the town wasn't generous enough to give us a little money back on our police. So we would like to keep the event going, so we're kind of hoping that we could earn a little money maybe having a beer garden. And we've got the approval from the Web Barn, or the people that run the Web Barn. They've agreed to it. And Sammy from Byright Liquors is going to help us apply for a one-day liquor license for that. We will man the booth and check identification and make sure everybody's legal. We hope you approve this.
Questions for Diane or Tom?
Do you have to have an extra police officer on duty for that?
We're hoping not.
Those are some of the things we got to work through.
Okay.
Other questions from council?
I guess, well, Webb Dean Stevens, they're okay with it?
Yes. They have
no problem?
Yes.
And it would be in their courtyard?
Yeah,
in the front?
Courtyard. Yes, in the courtyard area, okay. Out in front.
About what size would it be? Just having been at the one at the Cove Carnival, it's a good size beer garden. There was a lot of people, a lot of spillover of people outside of it.
We do want to kind of, maybe not as big as the Cove Carnival, but we were kind of pattering it off of the Cove Carnival.
Okay.
Sounds fun.
Yeah.
Not too much objection from the council, I suspect. Okay, we have a motion.
It's going to be December. So
yeah. Maybe some
exactly.
Hot apple cider.
It'll be December, yeah. So it'll be a little colder, so maybe there won't be so much
it.
Spillover.
Yeah. Toddies.
Yeah. Hot toddies.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Diane. 3B?
Make a motion to accept the Clean Energy Communities Municipal Pledge.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. This is a reiteration of a program we looked at years ago and somewhat participated in, but never fully endorsed. Eversource has kind of reworked the program where they would provide a lot of the PR and management of the program from a community level. So it kind of fits where we are with staffing and capabilities. There is a $10,000 grant for some kind of community outreach or community energy item that we'll work through once we sign up. But as you can see, we've done some things already, CPACE, and we're going to use the high school as the benchmark between 2010 and now. So I think it kind of fits where we are in our development here.
Very good. Questions for Jeff on this? Fairly straightforward, obviously, the packet. Mike?
What's the 20% clean, renewable energy? Do we already have some of that, like, being produced?
What it is we'll work with CROG as we purchase power to make sure that they're looking at renewables and kind of their energy package.
Oh, so it's the power we purchase?
We purchase. Okay. And then what's available in the community, those kind of things. So.
Any other questions?
Kind of fits with the state purchasing model.
Thank you. Yep. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? B3C.
Motion to approve rejecting the state offer to purchase 170 Ridge Road.
Second.
Motion and a second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. The state gave us a very generous offer of for the low, low price of $250,000, we could own a vintage 1912 building located in Wethersfield. The Public Works Committee reviewed this and is making the recommendation that we don't accept this. I've also discussed it with the Board of Ed superintendent. He's not interested, and they're not interested in this building. Otherwise, they don't have a use. So we're recommending that town express its gratitude for the offer, but rejecting it just the same. And I don't know if Tony has any comments as chairman of Public Works.
We did look at it in the price, but the condition of the building, the age of the building, we, number one, don't have a need for, and the hazardous material that's in that building would probably more than fourfold what the purchase price was. So that was partially the reason, too, that we rejected. We have no use, and to get a building at a bargain, it's going to cost us and sit there. It makes no sense to the taxpayers.
So in the event we don't purchase it, then they would put it for sale to the public. Under state law, they have to offer state-owned buildings to the local municipality first. And if they don't buy them, then they'll be offered to the public at a sale.
Do you know what that's zoned for?
Probably in that tax report.
I don't know if it's on the property record card or not.
Sent.
It says zone A1.
A1 is agricultural one, so I imagine it's just whoever buys it's going to have to come in for a new zoning application anyway, unless you're going to reuse it as a school.
Mm-hmm.
Motion and second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. 3D, I know Marlene is here, so... can I get a motion?
Motion to approve the write-off of the 2,000 uncollectible taxes per the request of the Wethersfield tax collector.
Second.
Marlene, to you. Yes.
Good evening. This is the oldest grand list. Taxes are only collectible 15 years, so this will be the 16th year, which we have to drop off because they're no longer legally collectible. Just a few vacant lots that we have around. Total is about $4,000 for the list.
I might.
Go ahead, Jeff.
A lot of these, the assessor has now put a minimum value on. So going forward, there won't be value for a tax bill. So as these cycle through that 15-year period, you will see less and less of these. Some of them are actually going through tax sale, and others are like Logish went to tax sale. No one purchased that, but the town will pick that up 6 months from now because it was part of the Conservation Commission's. It's on their list to acquire, so over time that'll come off this list.
Thank you. Questions for this? No, Marlene continues to get it done up there. Thank you. Motion is, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Just an interesting, Marlene's also included the collections we've gotten from the collection agency.
Yeah,
I think there's
good
some
report.
Good progress there.
Very good.
Getting some of that back, mostly personal property.
Okay, that's a good number. Thank you, Marlene, for your thing. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstention? Thank you. And finally, 3E.
Make a motion to approve the meeting dates of the Wethersfield Town Council for the year 2017.
Second.
Motion second. Jeff, this is fairly straightforward, posting of our next year.
Yeah, I think, I don't know if you want to go ahead and look at the November meeting, November 6th meeting, to go ahead and cancel that one. But that's been a practice the council has endorsed. So if there is a desire to go ahead and do that now, we can post that. And then probably look at, as we get to the next summer, what you want to do in the summertime. We've usually canceled in August in a July meeting, but those are up to you, and I don't know if Dolores has any. This is kind of her bailiwick.
I think we should do the November one now because we won't meet, okay. But then the summer ones maybe as we get into the budget season.
I just want to draw to your attention, though, for Independence Day in the summer, we're going to be closed Monday and Tuesday, because the unions voted on closing the Monday before. So if you have a meeting, you have to go to the middle of the week on Wednesday. It would be the first time.
That would be Wednesday the 6th or Thursday the 6th? Wednesday the 6th. Okay.
It's Wednesday the 5th.
Wednesday the 5th. So that,
it
that,
is correct,
that's what you're proposing here.
Yeah. Or, yes. And okay. Because it's your, it's it, none of those, two, the summer ones are, you will be the same council.
Yeah.
So this year you had canceled that Wednesday in the first one in both.
In July and August.
July and August.
So those are the likely ones reflecting what we did this year. I mean, we can take those off right now and post these as we think. And we can always add a meeting if the budget season takes us into an extra session. So we could take those off now. Right, Jeff?
Yeah, you can set your own schedule. Yeah, you can go one a month if you want.
you say ever so happily.
Now you're talking.
Just offering options, that's all.
If you do take them off now, then departments can
plan
better plan not having when their people
anybody object if we take off the 7.5 and the 8.7?
And what they need to give you.
Any objection if we do that now? Just modify this to...
We can always add it if we need it.
Always add,
oh,
yep.
Sure, absolutely.
All right, so, and, I mean, that's already written that way, so it's fine. All right, so we have a motion to approve those dates, noting those two off.
Just a quick question, Mike, about that. Prior to all this, you mentioned the union voted to take Monday the 3rd off.
Yeah.
Would they have Monday the 3rd and Tuesday the 4th off?
Right.
Yes. There are 12 holidays a year. They picked Monday and that Monday as in their 12th holiday.
Okay. What did they – do they give up a holiday? Do they not have Columbus Day or
– No, they just – they get 12 holidays by contract, and there's a process each year that we look at where the 12 fall. And there's normally a time where there's a double up of a day.
Yeah, like a Monday or a Friday.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
This year it just happened that
we do not take the 11th. We do not take November Veterans Day off in town because we have a whole series, a program that we run for the town that day.
Yeah. We're good. Pretty good. Okay, we have a motion and a second with those modifications. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or abstaining? Thank you. Approval of the special meeting of September 28th.
Make a motion to approve the meeting minutes of September 28th, 2016.
Second.
Any changes? Seeing none. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? And then finally, the approval of the meeting of October 3rd.
Make a motion to approve the meeting minutes of October 3rd.
Second.
Any changes there? Seeing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Abstain? Who knows? Thank you. Public comment. Anyone wishing to speak? Tom?
Good evening, Tom Mazzarella, 600 Walcott Hill Road. Just a couple comments about MDC. Maybe I'm just not getting it, but I don't understand the rationale of marketing a huge volume of water to Niagara and lowering the rate so you get the business. And now I'm hearing they have a shortfall of income. Now, obviously, Niagara is not online yet. I don't know when that is going to be completed. It's right behind my business in Bloomfield. Construction's moving along pretty rapidly. I don't know if we're still going to have a drought when they're in operation. But the way MDC's been operating, from what I read, I am sure that if there's a severe drought and we have to curtail our consumption in Wethersfield, we won't be able to water our lawns or wash our cars or whatever else the requirement is. And I am sure they'll enforce that same restriction on Niagara, so they'll have to shut their sprinklers off in front of their plant. And they won't be able to wash their cars, but they'll still use 500,000 gallons of water and sell it for more than they're paying for it. I just think that's ridiculous. And I think the town of Wethersfield, as a member of MDC, should have voiced their disapproval of that program. And now that the reservoirs are dropping rapidly, I think the town should send MDC a letter stating their dissatisfaction with what's going on and demand that if we get into a severe drought, they curtail water sales to Niagara, not just shutting off their sprinklers, but actually cutting the supply of water to someone that's profiting off of it, when the rest of the MDC members are going to have to worry about whether they have enough water to take a shower and cook their meals and things like that. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Public comment? Other public comment? Bob?
Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. I too am very concerned over the MDC water issue. Their budget is short. I went by their reservoir yesterday, Saturday, Sunday, across that bridge or the where the dam is out here in Bark Hampstead. You can see where the water level was going down. Of course, I do recall them having in the paper where they said it's a deep lake. But still, when you start seeing the water going down, and I don't know how much deeper down it goes, but there's concern. And it's a shame that the managers at the MDC planned so poorly. They planned poorly on giving a lot of water away for a cheap price, whereas the rest of us who are been around here for a long time, we pay premium price. And I think that's something wrong. The Niagara Bottling Company is from somewhere else, yet they got the bargain. The rest of citizens in the district of the water company continue to pay the top price. And when the drought is announced by MDC, we will be cutting back, and we'll be told whatever we're going to use, and that's too bad, because our managers at the MDC made a big error for a few extra dollars, and we should be demanding resignations from those people. I don't know why we haven't yet, but that's something which you should be doing. Why not? They screwed up. Show them the road. It goes north and south, east and west. Go. I know there was a lot of talk tonight, or you spoke, Mayor, regarding your six-mayor meeting regarding Hartford and their problems. And I would urge you to recommend to the mayor of Hartford he should file bankruptcy. He could save a lot of money. He could unload a lot of his debt on investors. And also he could clean up some of his labor problems through the court systems. And I really think that's what Hartford needs to do. It's so bad and so corrupt up there, it won't matter. It's the people that will suffer, and that's what happens. It's like here. You nine folks make the decisions, and the rest of us, we suffer for it. You make an error, you're not accountable, only at the ballot booth. But if your party is strong enough, you're back here again, and you should be gone. But that doesn't happen. So I would really recommend a bankruptcy for Hartford. It would do the whole darn region a good favor. Because adding more regional taxes and these other things that we've been reading about aren't going to work, at least not with me. And of course now, in the Sunday newspaper, John Lender was reporting how some of the rest areas here in the state of Connecticut are closing their rest areas during certain hours of the day, which the accommodations that they're putting out there for the people that are traveling on those highways, it sounds pretty pathetic. And for saving $2 million, Malloy could have laid off 20 of his cronies. Those are Democrat cronies. And I'm sure there's a couple Republican cronies up there. Get rid of them. And all the people who travel through this state won't be suffering from lack of good sanitation facilities. Instead, we keep those cronies on, and we chase people away. And from reading in the newspaper, it sounds like there's going to be a lot of comments. Now, tonight, you just gave $550 away for this Main Street thing, or you're planning on doing that? Yes, no?
No, I think I didn't hear that, you misunderstood. Right? That was what they made last year.
Oh, that's what they made. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Well, how about this $10,000 grant? We got to borrow some more, get some more borrowed money from the state or from
somewhere? Actually, that's ratepayer money that is put aside for clean energy projects. You pay that already. It's not borrowed money.
For ratepayers? Mm-hmm. From what? The MDC? Or the...
No, from the, you pay your electric bill.
On your electric bill?
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to get $10,000 from them?
From Eversource, yes.
Why are we paying that extra?
No.
Why are we paying that extra money? They should just eliminate it. And
well, that's a legislative question.
Let us have a little savings. Instead of them divvying it up to whoever they want to divvy it up to.
Yeah.
And I don't know, Mayor. We're in bad shape. Wish you well.
Thank you, Bob.
Wish you well, all
appreciate
of you.
Appreciate it. Other public comment? We have adjourned executive session.
Yeah.
Okay. Can I get a motion to go into executive session?
Motion to go into executive session.
We have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Aye.
2 minutes, but this guy's about.
Yeah.
We're going, we're staying here, we're going in there. We're going there.
I'm out of here.
Yes.
So, good luck, Chris.
Yes,
yeah.
It's on the
yeah. The covers. And the calls.
No one's going to write about what you're
doing. I think you're right.
Oh, yeah, there it is.
What's your reaction?